Today's Not the Show is brought to you by Audible.com. Get a free audiobook download at audibletrial.com/nottheshow. Over 100,000 titles to choose from to listen to on your iPhone, Android, Kindle, or any other MP3 player. audibletrial.com/notheshow. Good evening and welcome to Not the Show. My name is Joe.
And my name is Mondo.
There you are now. You were off screen there for a second. Sorry.
Oh, no worries.
So how are you this week?
That was 12 Heads in a Bag by the Crayolas.
I like that song, actually. I'm looking forward to hearing the rest at the end of the show.
A little Tex-Mex there.
Yeah, it was good stuff. So what's new, buddy?
Oh, not much. Not much. I'm. You know, Gallagher is new. Gallagher is out of his coma.
Wow. I didn't even know he was in a coma.
Neither did I. Apparently, Gallagher going into a coma is not big news, but Gallagher coming out of a coma, I haven't been able to escape that. Between people talking about how the doctors are thinking about bringing him out medically, like slowly, and then he is out of his coma, and I'm just sitting here reading all these things, thinking to myself, when the fuck did Gallagher go into a coma?
That's a very good question. I didn't know one bit that Gallagher.
I'm getting news alerts that Gallagher is out of his coma.
Wow.
I did not get one news alert that he went into one. Apparently, he had a heart attack last week and went into a coma.
Yeah.
Well, Gallagher in a coma. I know it's serious.
Well, I'm glad he's coming out of his coma.
Yeah, I guess so. What's new with you?
Nothing much. It's been a one of those weekends. We're potty training.
I saw that on the Facebook.
Yeah. It's not easy. It's a stressful time.
Yeah, I can imagine.
He's getting the hang of it a little. We'll get there. He's little. He's young. We got plenty of time.
Yeah, I saw a lot of advice. People were giving you advice to just let the kid run around naked.
Yeah, and that's all
fine. How does that work?
I guess because peeing on the floor is a very obvious thing that happens, and you can... You're supposed to say things like, next time if you tell me beforehand, we'll get you to the bathroom in time and you can go and pee-pee in the potty. You know, going in a diaper or in underwear, they could almost ignore it, especially right. A diaper. Even those pull-up things are very diapery.
Right.
Okay. Underwear, we've been using underwear. We tried that for a couple of days. But then he had a fever today. I think he's got a bit of a cold. So we let him revert back that we did pull-ups all day today, and we had a couple of successful times where he caught it in time and asked us in time. But he's got to go to daycare. He can't be naked all day.
Yeah.
You know, so some people said wait until we have a whole week off from work, like, you know, spring break for Jen or summer.
Right.
And I guess if we don't have very much luck doing it with underwear and pull-ups, you know, we'll get more serious when she has more time off.
Sure.
But we're going to send pull-ups to school, and she says his teacher says all the other kids in his class are currently in pull-ups and toilet training, so she's all in for helping, and she's been doing it for years, so I guess that's good.
I guess it's a lot better than having like all those kids running around naked, just like crapping on the floor.
We've actually had more success with crap than pee. Surprising. Usually it's harder to get them to poop in the... Listen to us. Usually it's harder to get them to shit in the potty. But he, at least twice on his own, has come to me and said, without prompting, and said, gotta poop. And I put him on the potty and he's gone on the potty. It's pee that he doesn't seem to... It doesn't seem to bother him to have a wet diaper. So because right. It doesn't bother him to have a wet diaper, there's no incentive. And that's why we try with underwear, because he wets his underwear in his pants or just his underwear if we're letting him walk around. And it's, it's unpleasant, more unpleasant. So that, I guess that's the point. Peeing on the floor, I suppose, is even more unpleasant. And that's what the reason was for that was. All the naked comments.
Okay, I guess that makes sense then.
Yeah, I suppose. We'll see. I'll have more to report next week, I guess.
And I definitely could see where, like, you know, crap in your pants would definitely be more uncomfortable than pee in your pants. Like, depending, like, you know. I mean, people pee their pants all the time.
Sure.
I'm going to pee my pants right now.
Awesome.
All right, I really won't. But, you know, Gallagher probably peed his pants while he was in that coma.
I bet you he did.
Probably. They probably had him in pull-ups. No, actually, probably regular diaper. I suppose that'd be easier for coma. What do they do with coma patients?
I don't know.
They probably like have everything like going out in tubes, don't they?
Catheter, probably.
Right, catheter and like maybe a. They probably put them on a low shit diet.
Yeah.
I don't remember what they call that, but you know. The diet where you don't poop a lot. Here we are with poop again.
High fiber.
No, that would make you poop too much.
No, low fiber.
Yeah, low fiber and, you know, astronauts, Gallagher is not an astronaut, but astronauts, they eat, like, low-waste diets. Like, their diets are so that they don't have to crap as often.
Yeah, okay, I've heard that.
Because, you know, yeah, because shitting in space is messy and difficult, I suppose. You could get sucked out of the turlet into the vacuum of space. You try to avoid that.
Yeah, I think I would try to avoid that. So while we're talking about space, let's talk about Prometheus for a minute.
Yeah, let's talk about Prometheus.
We can talk more about pottying and other stuff later if we like. But
we can probably bring it up with every topic we discuss.
Probably. So
let's see if we can.
So Prometheus is due out one of these days, beginning of the summer, I think. And they've been doing all kinds of viral marketing. And at South by Southwest this year, they finally released the official full trailer. And I happen to have it right here.
Oh, that's fantastic.
Yeah, let's watch the trailer. Let me put that up in front of your camera. Because who needs to see you? We're just going to see the trailer. And I'll switch to your camera here. Click. And here we go. Let's check this out. I switched it to high def.
In a world gone mad.
That doesn't look like space.
No.
A king has his reign. And then he dies. It's inevitable.
Prometheus has been. Ancient civilizations that were separated by centuries, and yet, this same pictogram was discovered in every one of them.
They're smiling.
I think they want us to come and find them.
We're all here because of a map you two kids found in a cave.
Not a map, an invitation.
From whom?
Please tell me you can read that.
Prometheus, are you seeing this?
That was Magneto.
Whatever that probe's picking up, it's reading life form.
What do you mean a life form?
Oh, the head.
Changing. Changing into what?
It's moving. This thing's moving.
What is that?
Did you catch that?
The ship.
Yes.
They're leaving.
To
I wish YouTube had a slow motion setting so you could kind of watch all of that in very slow motion.
Right.
Here, I'm gonna
move. Because there is a lot going on in that.
Yeah, I'm going to move to that spot that I mentioned. See if we can get it on camera here for everybody else. See if we catch the Giger. It was a picture of Lee, wasn't that? That's Lee, right? Is that, that's when I said, did you catch that? Maybe you didn't catch the same thing I saw.
Maybe.
These things moving?
There. Recognize that? I have that picture on my wall.
Oh, yeah, look at that.
Very cool. Very cool. Anyway.
Yeah, this looks really good.
It does. I don't know why I'm surprised, but it really does look great. A lot of there was definitely something big and alien-y walking around. Not alien we're used to, but yeah, it looks cool.
Yeah, absolutely. And you know, very alien-y alien type mm-hmm. stuff. I mean, like you know, I think, you know, you kind of catch a glimpse of what could potentially possibly be a face hugger.
Yeah, they did say get it. It was like a lot of that get it off, get it off.
Get it off, yeah, get it off.
Yeah, we had a lot of that back in the other Alien movies.
That's what Gallagher was saying when he woke up. His watermelon burst open and Alien came out.
Poor Gallagher.
Poor Gallagher.
I think he's misunderstood in his own time.
So do I.
You know, do you ever think he ever smashed an alien head with a giant mallet?
I think if he hasn't, he should.
That'd be a good idea. I should send him. He should be the one to go check out on LB, LV. I don't remember the name of the planet anymore.
LV-428.
Yeah, that's right. They should have sent him up there to smash those alien eggs with a giant hammer.
Making bad jokes. So we were like wrapped in a poncho.
I think Jen and I saw him live at one point in our lives.
Really?
Yeah, that's kind of sad.
Well, you know, I don't know. Gallagher's, you know, I've always thought actually that Gallagher is pretty funny as a comedian. I'm not so much sure about the watermelon smashing thing. It's like I couldn't listen to a lot of Gallagher, but a couple times I've seen him do his like stand-up act.
Yeah.
You know, it's been pretty funny. And then when he busts out the watermelons, that's when I'm kind of like, yes, I know. You bust watermelons. We all know this.
Yeah. Anyway, the movie looks good.
Yeah, it does.
Yeah. I didn't get to see John Carter this week, but I wanted to. I'll go see it.
Poor John Carter.
Yeah, I have to try and go see it soon because I don't think it's going to last very long.
Yeah, it's not. It's not.
Didn't do very well.
No, it didn't.
And it should have done better. I don't know what... Maybe Disney screwed up the marketing. I guess that's what...
I definitely think Disney screwed up the marketing. Absolutely, without a doubt.
I also think it's a bit of a hard sell. I mean, it looks cool. So if you're into that sort of movie, looking at a trailer may get you to go see it. But it's a... I mean, why did they choose 100 years after the book came out to make this movie? Do you have any idea?
Because nobody wanted to touch it for whatever reason.
Yeah.
You know, I've heard rumors that Flash Gordon started out as a John Carter serial.
Mm.
And then, you know how things like change once, like, you know, people get involved and they're just like, well, why don't we do this and why don't we do this? And I don't know how true this is, but that's what I heard, is like Flash Gordon originally started out as a John Carter thing that changed to the point that it was no longer a John Carter thing.
Hmm.
Again, I don't know how true that is, but I did hear that somewhere.
Right. Well, I guess it's possible.
You know, they maybe should have,
sort of,
like,
almost,
you know,
sounds likely.
Yeah, I mean, you know, they maybe should have pushed the books, like, you know, a while ago when they started thinking about producing this. They maybe should have just, like, tried to revitalize the books, maybe do some graphic novels, you know, team up with whoever it is Disney owns. I'm sure they own a comic company or two. In fact, I'm almost positive that they're involved with Marvel.
I think they own Marvel now, yeah.
Yeah, I think they do own Marvel. So, yeah. You know, it's like, come out with some graphic novels, get some interest going, because, you know, like I've said, you know, since the news first hit that they were going to do this, I was like, no one even knows what this is. I'm excited about it, but very few people know what John Carter is.
Yeah.
And then they leave out the whole Mars thing from the...
The title, right?
Right.
Yeah, that was a bad idea, too.
Yeah, and the reason for doing that was, like, you know, movies with the Mars in the title just don't do well.
And look at what Ridley Scott is doing for Prometheus. They're doing, you know, crazy websites. I mean, the way they released the trailer at South by Southwest, the first there was like a promotional website that had nothing on it, and it's just like the word Prometheus in the center of the screen, and it was almost like the it was almost like check out our newest ship by Wayland Company Shipbuilders, the Prometheus, right? And I'm assuming once the trailer went live, the site turned live.
Right.
I haven't seen it since that splash screen that didn't go anywhere. But they're trying, you know, they're doing a lot of, I don't know that Ridley Scott needed too much promotion for this movie, but maybe it did. You know, Alien and Aliens, they're old a long time ago. You know, we're old. You know, they're aiming for young, you know, the best audiences for these movies are 18 to 24, right? That's the demographic they want to get for them all.
Right.
And by doing lots of viral kind of marketing and going to South by Southwest and showing the film and websites, things like that are what gets kids to see movies.
Exactly.
Yeah, you know, getting a little bit of buzz about it, and Disney's a huge company. They could have, I mean, Ridley Scott is Ridley Scott, but I don't even know who's backing that movie. Do you know if it's did it say Universal? Maybe it was Universal.
20th Century Fox.
Okay, so yeah. You know, they've got big backers, but Disney should have done more, especially for a film this expensive. I read somewhere that it might be the most expensive flop in movie history.
Really?
Yeah. I mean, I don't know how they predict that after only 2 weeks being out, but. And I think it did well in Europe, actually.
It did.
You know, so
it did, yeah.
You know, calling it a flop doesn't mean it's not going to make as much money. It just means it didn't make a lot of money. It doesn't necessarily mean that it's not making money.
It's not making the money they want to make.
Right. All you people out there that are not that are hearing this, it made worldwide. It made $179 million as of now. The film cost, if you add in. $100 million for advertising, the film cost $350 million. So it's at $200. Production budget was $250 plus $100 for advertising, like I said.
Right.
So I'm guessing that they may make it in the theater. They may make it that $150 that they need to get back their money. But they'll definitely make it in DVD and video sales.
Sure.
So I would never feel bad for these companies. I don't care how much of a flop they say it is. It'll do fine in the end, or at least it'll break even.
Right. Disney won't be hurt.
No, we don't have to worry about Disney going out of business.
We have to worry about Gallagher, but we don't have to worry about Disney.
That's right. What else do we have in movie end of things? We have a couple of rumors. We'll get to those. We have a Doctor Who. Oh, I just closed something that I shouldn't have closed. Let me reopen one sec. Sin City, that's the one I closed. So there's Robert Rodriguez said that they're finally gonna start making the sequel to Sin City.
Been waiting forever for that.
Yeah, fantastic movie. Been a while. I haven't seen it in ages.
Me either. You know, I'm pretty sure. I mean, I know I bought it on DVD. I guess my question right now to myself is like, do I still have it? After all the moving I've done, I have to go see if I have it. If I don't have it, it's at Chuck's house. Or I lent it to somebody and just never got it back. That's always possible, too.
Chuck's still living in the old house? Or did he move?
No, he moved. He's living in Bloomington. Mm. It's like somewhere between my old house and where Red lives.
Okay, a little closer to the city.
Closer, yeah, not me. Much. Not much.
Okay. So in South by Southwest, Robert Rodriguez did an interview with Hollywood Reporter that said that Sin City's back on track. Finally, should go into production this summer. No word yet on who will be in it, but he said that the star power will be of the same caliber and eclecticism. We do know some of the stories he plans to tell. He told MovieWeb that the sequel will be based on the comic storyline A Dame to Kill For plus two brand new stories written by Frank Miller.
Ooh, new stories.
He hinted that it would want the film to be both a prequel and a sequel, weaving the storylines from before and after the original story. It's interesting. Sounds good. Sounds like a good plan.
That does sound good. So I'm hoping Mickey Rourke comes back as Marv.
Oh, yeah, I guess he should. You know, he's got that resurgence of his career going on at the moment, doesn't he?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, and if they're doing it, like, you know, with stuff from before... You know, I mean, because he died at the end of his story in the original Sin City. But, you know, in the comics, you know, he showed up in some of the stories that had taken place before. So, I like Mickey Rourke in that.
Cool.
That was the start, I think, of his big resurgence.
Yeah, maybe.
I think the Sin City was like, you know, was the beginning.
ended with Iron Man 2?
Iron Man 2 or the Expendables. Expendables. I don't remember which came out first, but he also did the Expendables.
Yeah, and the Wrestler movie.
Oh yeah, the Wrestler movie. I forgot about that. I haven't seen it yet, which is one reason why I might have forgotten about it.
Yeah, it was good actually. There was one more. I don't remember.
Yeah.
Doesn't really matter anyway.
Well, you know, he also did that one movie with that Puss in Boots guy. And also Robert Rodriguez. Once Upon a Time in Mexico, the third mariachi movie.
Yeah. Forgot about that one.
I called him the Puss in Boots guy.
Excuse me. So they're rebooting the Vacation movies.
Oh, good, because we needed that.
Sounds like Rusty will be the focus of these movies. He's grown up, and he wants to take his own family on their first vacation, and they're going to go to Wally World.
Now, which Rusty will this be?
Because
there are a number of Rustys.
There were. It doesn't say who the grown-up Rusty will be. It says that they're trying to get Chevy Chase and Beverly D'Angelo to return as Clark and Ellen Griswold. And there's also been several of the sisters. What was her name?
I can't remember.
Yeah, me either. they don't say who's going to play either of the kids, but that's going to probably be a bad movie. I think they're going to get Billy Joel's ex-wife again to drive by in a car.
That would be good. She'd be like she's probably the one who's aged the best.
Probably. She was in the last one, Vegas. Last one I think was Vegas Vacation. Which wasn't a terrible movie, but she drove past and was making googly eyes at Clark, and then when she passed a little further, she had two car seats in the back of her car with babies in them.
I remember that.
Yeah.
I remember that. That's right. I actually did see that movie.
I didn't hate it. Maybe because they made the daughter was a cute girl. That's why I didn't hate that movie.
Right.
And you know who played? Oh, yeah. Who played the... A currently famous actor who wasn't famous then played the son, played who we were just talking about. I'm getting it now. Rusty, Ethan Embry, right? So Ethan Embry is has been in like a million things since then. Do you know who I'm talking about?
No, I don't.
He was in... let's see, some stuff that we would remember. Bunch of TV stuff. Oh, see, that's not good. Harold and Kumar Go to White Castle. He was one of Harold and Kumar's classmates. He was in Sweet Home Alabama. See, these are not good things. I've seen him in about 1,000 things. But none of these Disturbing Behavior, Vegas Vacation. That Thing You Do. He was the bass player in That Thing You Do.
Oh, okay.
Empire Records. He played Mark.
right.
He was going to name his band Mark, but Mark with a C, not Mark with a K.
Right.
Do you know who I'm talking about now?
Yes.
And the reason I liked him in the movie so much is at the end, he played four slot machines and he won four cars. And he just said, I put a dollar and I win a car. I put a dollar and I win a car. I put a dollar and I win a car. I put a dollar and I win a car. And they're just like, because he won like a Hummer, a Mustang. I don't know. that movie has a soft spot for me, at least.
Yeah, Anthony Michael Hall was he the first Rusty? I think
yes, he was the first Rusty.
I would like him to come back as Rusty.
He could come back as the Rusty, a dad now, couldn't he? He's sure. Right about that age, and he's probably like our age or so. He could,
absolutely.
Yeah, that would be awesome. And not like he's doing anything anyway, right? Like, he finished up with his Stephen King TV series.
He did. The last thing I saw him in was it could have been old. I can't remember what the hell it was for the life of me now. But he was a news reporter. Oh, Dark Knight.
Okay, yeah.
He was the news reporter in The Dark Knight. A Joker hung him upside down at one point. I don't remember if he survived that movie. I'm going to guess he probably didn't.
Probably not.
Did anyone survive that movie? So that clears him up to do...
Vacation. Whatever they're calling it. I think they're just calling it Vacation again.
Well, I'll tell you, I am... when it comes to things that need to be rebooted, this is probably at the top of the list of things that really didn't need to be rebooted. But you know, if they're gonna play it like a if they're gonna play it like a sequel, that's cool.
Yeah, it would be. I think that the premise is that Wally World is closing and they want to get there before it closes for good. And I'm assuming they'll show up at the end and it'll already be closed.
Right.
You know.
And they'll break in.
Yeah.
John Candy won't be there.
No, he won't.
Gallagher might be.
Oh, man. What else we have newsy? We have The Cabin in the Woods. So this is a Joss Whedon movie, and it's not out yet. Nope. But they did do a screening at South by Southwest. A lot of South by Southwest movie news this week.
Yeah, actually, that's one of the reasons why I picked the Crayolas to for the opening song was a little South by Southwest flavor.
Cool. Yeah. So we like Joss Whedon. He's good.
Love him.
He does lots of cool stuff. We're fans. But this one looked weird, this Cabin in the Woods thing. I didn't know what to make of it, right? It was coming across as like just a monster movie in a cabin, you know, with attractive teens that go to a cabin and start getting killed.
Right.
Well, it turns out it's significantly more than that. There's like, I saw a trailer, which I should have pulled for the show, but there's like a room in the house with giant screens and computers. It's almost like someone put them in this house for some kind of a study, almost. Right. I don't know if that's the premise, but the IO9 has an article about Cabin in the Woods, and it says, yes, Cabin in the Woods is that fucking good.
Wow.
Do you miss the biting dialogue and clever characters that filled the Whedonverse of Buffy, Firefly, and Angel? Then Cabin in the Woods is the movie for you. The whole movie feels like a very special Buffy episode in a genre that's currently buried under scraps from the success of past torture porn and found footage horror films. Cabin is a shining beacon of promise for people that don't need shaky cam to get their fear fetish rocks off. It's the thinking geeks horror film, and we love it so much we want to pony it up and buy it a hotel room after prom. Seriously, we want Cabin in the Woods inside of us.
Wow. That is a glowing review.
It is. The guy says... The things that are good about it, he says, the comedy. He says, hot Christ, is this film funny. So funny. Not just LOL, there's a hippie with a bong funny, although that is there. It's we know you're watching. Now watch us turn all this around and scare you with the silliest horror trope in the history of the world funny. He says that the writing, he said, paired with the comedy and the whole twisted plot deserves its own positive plug. Not once does anything feel forced or like some kind of jury-rigged teenage vernacular penned by a bunch of old guys desperately trying to court the teenage audience. The dialogue, the plot, the big reveals, all great. Even if you don't agree with the final verdict, you can't help but admit that the whole thing is delivered in style. And then they said there are so many Easter eggs that they need to see Cabin again. Boards are covered in clues, cellars are stuffed with items that had more than one meaning. Heck, the cabin itself is a bright, shining Easter egg from movies past. The whole thing is stuffed with clues and monstrous secrets. We just know we won't be satisfied until the Blu-ray comes out and we can go through this entire film shot by shot.
Huh. That sounds, I don't know, that sounds really good.
It sounds glowing. Oh, you know, I got the trailer here. Let me see if I can pull it up. Oh, trailer. I'm going to put it in front of your camera again.
Groovy.
Yeah, I'm curious enough, right? We got a little time.
Absolutely.
We're not in a big rush here. Look how it says on top. You've never seen a Hunger trailers like this before.
Hey, everybody.
Sorry.
Everybody ready? Let's go on the road.
Doesn't even show up on the GPS. Is unworthy of global positioning.
That's the whole point. Get off the grid, right?
Hello?
I'm thinking this thing doesn't take credit cards.
Time says closed.
We're looking for, what's it called?
Tillerman Road.
Not to get you there. Getting back. That's your concern.
This is awesome.
Whoa. No way.
the gate. They are come to the killing floor.
Let's get this party started!
I seriously believe something weird is going on. What is that thing?
We have to stay together. This isn't right. We should split up.
Yeah, good idea.
Really?
We gotta get out of here.
Somebody sent those things here to get us.
You're missing the point. They want to see us punished.
Not bad.
Not bad at all. That looks really good.
Only about halfway through, I realized it was showing me at the same time as you. I think my little camera that's there, I hadn't switched it to you. Let's see, switch to you. Switch. It's okay.
Yeah, it's okay.
People watching saw it a little bit smaller than they would have.
Well, it'll be on the website.
Yeah, I'll post it up there.
Yeah.
As long as I remember to, because I haven't done it yet. But I'll post it up there.
I wonder if Gallagher will go see that.
He should. Did the cabin look? Is the cabin supposed to look like the cabin from Evil Dead? Is that what the IO9 writer was implying when he said even the cabin is an Easter egg?
Maybe.
Yeah.
Because it definitely kind of does.
Yeah. That'd be cool. I like that sort of stuff. So there's two more Joss Whedon stories, but they're about TV, so I'm gonna save them. The last thing I want to talk about in the news is that the Dark Tower movie sounds like it's back in production.
Back on.
Yeah. Warner Brothers Pictures says they're very close to bringing the Dark Tower back to life, with Ron Howard still signed to direct at least the first film, and Javier Bardem is still attached to play Roland, and the same writers, Avika Goldsman, Brian Grazer, and King himself are all on board to produce.
So we'll have to see.
If the deal goes through, it could begin rolling cameras in the first movie as early as the first quarter of 2013. And Goldsman is doing some fine-tuning on the screenplay in preparation for that. HBO is still apparently going to carry the TV component, which is convenient, since it's the same conglomerate as Warner Brothers.
Right.
So that's awesome.
That is awesome.
Yeah. We will talk more about that in detail on the Discordia 19 podcast. It'll be out sometime middle of the week this week. I think what we're going to talk about is whether or not it even should be made. We've been up for this for a long time now, but I've been thinking about it, and I read this article that made me think, but I'm not sure anymore. So if you're intrigued, come go to discordia19.com sometime middle of the week, and that show will be up there. We'll talk a bit more about Dark Tower.
You know, we might talk a little bit about Carrie, too, if you don't mind.
No, that's cool.
Because I saw, just last night, I saw Carrie, the remake.
Oh.
Yeah, not Carrie the musical, and okay. Not Carrie 2, the Electric Boogaloo, whatever they called it. But
you saw a remade Carrie.
Yeah, the remade Carrie. I think it looked like it was a TV thing, but it's on the Netflix, and Ange and her friend were watching it.
Okay.
And you know, I made some mental notes, so I would definitely like to discuss a little Carrie.
Good. We'll talk about that on the Discordia podcast, discordia19.com. So let's get to some business, and then we'll take our break. So tonight's podcast, is brought to you this week by audible.com. And the listeners of Not the Show can get a free audiobook download. And all you have to do is sign up for a free 30-day trial to give you an opportunity to check out their service. They have just about every book you can imagine. Everything. I mean, you know, we talk a lot about Stephen King and sci-fi here, and they've got a huge sci-fi collection. They've got, millions of Stephen King books, all unabridged. And you can get any of them for free. All you have to do is sign up for a one-month trial, and you go to audibletrial.com/notheshow. That's audibletrial.com/notheshow for your free audiobook. We talked the other day that The Stand just came out unabridged audio. It's surprising that, you know, a 25-year-old book just came out in audio. But it's available on audible.com. And here, I'm going to play a little sample of the audiobook for you.
Nice.
Texaco sat on number 93 just north of Arnett, a pissant four-street burg about 110 miles from Houston. Tonight, the regulars were there, sitting by the cash register, drinking beer, talking idly, watching the bugs fly into the big lighted sign.
This is narrated by Grover Gardner.
It was
Gardner.
Bill Hapscom's station.
Regular price would be $33.60, and you can get that for free just for signing up at audibletrial.com/notthe show.
And you've got nothing to lose.
Nothing to lose. You don't have to continue. You still get to keep your one book. You could listen on any of the major gadgets, iPods, iPhones, iPads, Android devices, even your Kindles, even a regular old Kindle, black and white, they play audio files from Audible. So head over to audibletrial.com/notthe show, and you can listen to John Carter, A Princess of Mars, which is the movie John Carter is based on. I got a little bit of that too.
Agreed that I was to hold down our claim against the remote possibility of its being jumped by some wandering prospector. On March 3rd, 1866, Powell and I packed his provisions on two
Audible Mondo's. Is pretty awesome. I was a member of Audible for a long time, still am. I love audiobooks. You don't need to go out and buy the CDs anymore or any of that stuff. Anything you buy is always saved for you in your Audible account. So. Forever. So if in 10 years you still want to listen to a book that you bought a long time ago, you can just go back into your account, listen again, re-download to whatever device you happen to have at that time. It's great. Audible's great. So
they are great. Yeah, I had an Audible account for a while.
Yeah, well, yeah, that's pretty awesome. So head over to audibletrial.com/notthe show so we can get a little credit, and subscribe for your free audiobook now.
This song says, no matter who you are, no matter where you go in your life, at some point you're gonna need somebody to stand by you. Thank you. Thank you.
And we're back.
Who was that?
That was a group of people called Playing for Change. They're at playingforchange.com. They're like a charitable organization that's trying to connect people through music. And what they kind of do is that they have musicians from all around the world, and they each record pieces of all these songs. So there were a lot of different musicians involved in that song, a lot of different singers. You could hear different voices all over. And, you know, the people involved in, for example, in that song, they have a whole bunch of songs. But in that one, there's somebody from South Africa, the Netherlands, France, Spain, Louisiana, Grandpa Elliot from New Orleans. He's a very famous New Orleans street performer. From the Congo, South Africa, Michigan, Italy, California. And they don't bring all these people together. They record each piece separately, and they put it all together in the end. So nice. All these people, you know, they send crews to all these different places. And, yeah, so it's that one was one of their first. They did it, recorded about 4 years ago. And they tracked down over 35 musicians to collaborate from all around the world. And they probably never met in person any of these people.
Wow.
And yeah, it's a very cool version of that. I love that version, and so, and I have a whole album of stuff by them. But they have other pretty popular songs. They're all over YouTube and Vimeo, and you know, playingforchange.com has all their stuff, and you can buy the albums.
Cool. Is Gallagher stuff. Involved in that?
Yeah, I think he might be.
Excellent.
Gotta have someone smashing watermelons when you're trying to get music played.
I thought I heard, like, you know, I thought the beat, like one of the backbeats in the background was the sound of a watermelon being smashed with a sledgehammer over and over.
I think you're right. I think it was.
It was like, you know, check the friend feed. I sent something. We can maybe use as a TV drop.
Oh.
I want to find a better quality one. But
do you want me to play it on the show? Or do you want me to just save it?
Yeah, let's try it out. Like I said, I want to find a better quality one.
All right there. All right there. Look, listen, Neil, Fred. Marshall.
Oh, I like it.
That's from 12 Monkeys.
Cool. I dig that. That's cool. So, yeah, we're going to talk about TV now. Excuse me. I have a little cough. I wonder if that's why my kid has a fever.
Maybe. Y'all getting each other sick.
Damn kids. So Joss Whedon again. He says that the waiting will stop for a new episode of Dr. Horrible.
Let's hope.
Yeah. Dr. Horrible was a really awesome, like, I don't even know what to call it. It was like it was a musical. It was an internet TV show.
It was a sing-along blog.
Right. And it was eventually put out you can get it on DVD and rent it, and maybe even Netflix. I think it's on Netflix now.
I know it definitely was on Netflix. I bet you it still is. I mean, I haven't watched it on the Netflix in a while, but I know it was for like the longest time.
Right. So Joss Whedon created it during the writer's strike from back in 2007 to 2008, and it tells the tale of a wannabe supervillain who wants to join the evil league of evil and win the girl of his dreams, Felicia Day.
She's the girl of everybody's dreams.
She has her own podcast network now, by the way, and Sword and Laser, which is one of the podcasts that Not the Show enjoys, is moving to video format from their audio-only format, and they're going to be on Felicia Day's podcast network.
How do we get to be on Felicia Day's podcast network?
I think you got to be minorly famous and have more downloads than about 100 a week.
All right, so we need to get famous.
We do.
Just so she can occasionally write us a letter and say, like, you know, really? About Gallagher again, you guys? Really? But it doesn't matter because it would be from her.
You know,
I'm so smitten.
You got to go to a con. I mean, I think she's very cordial to fans and stuff. I think she's, you know, but you got to go to some place where she's doing something, like a con. She's at almost every con, you know, these days. So, yeah, one day we'll get down to one of those things. Maybe we'll get to meet Felicia Day.
Yeah, because, you know, one of the reasons I think she's like that, I mean, not that I'm saying, like, you know, I'm sure there's a lot of actors and actresses that are like that, but I mean, it's like a, you know, she's like a geek made good, as opposed to, like, somebody who's, like, a serious actor who just happened to play a geek role and is now, like, you know, king of the geeks without even really wanting to be.
No, you're right.
She started out as a geek, and then she just got, you know, she made good.
Yeah, she did. Well, she has her own, she has that show she's still doing, our internet show.
Yeah, I love that show.
Yeah.
The Guild.
The Guild, right.
Yep, and then Nathan gamers. Fillion, he's a geek too, man. He's a huge geek.
Right, he was on Dr. Horrible.
Right, he was Captain Hammer.
Yeah.
Hammer is his penis.
While we're talking about him, Joss Whedon also says he hasn't given up on a revival of Firefly. Awesome, although this is the first I've ever heard of that. I've heard of all the cast saying that they wanted to do it. They just need Joss to be on the bandwagon with them. Almost every person in the cast I've heard say they would do more episodes or a movie or whatever. But this is the first time I've ever heard Joss Whedon say that he was willing or mildly thinking about it. That's awesome.
That is awesome. I mean, I hope they do something.
Yeah, I mean, Nathan Fillion has even said on his own that he would even produce and do it himself if he had to, although I think he'd have to buy the rights from whoever owns it, Fox or some shit like that. But wasn't there a weird, when we first started doing the show, wasn't there a weird, like, get the fans to buy the rights to the show donation thing going on?
Yeah, because Captain Tight Pants there, Nathan Fillion, he said something along those lines. Like, mm-hmm. I'm not going to say he was kidding, because he wasn't really kidding, but he was just being, like, hopeful. It's like, you know, wow, if I could do this, this is what I would do.
Right, he had to retract it, didn't he?
Right, because everybody was like, oh, well, he said that if we do this, this is what he'll do. That's not quite what he said.
No.
It was just like, in a perfect world, I would love to just get enough money to buy the rights and just do the shit forever.
Right, I think he had to tell people to stop sending him money.
Yeah. Because, you know, he ate a lot of Twinkies or something with that money. I was going to say, it's like I love the man to death, and I don't think he's in bad shape. But I've been noticing on Castle, he's been putting on a little weight.
Yeah, now when I'm looking at this picture on the Blaster of this article, he was really a lot smaller back then.
He was. And again, this is not a case of the pot calling the kettle fat, because, you know, Lord knows we're big guys, Joe.
Yeah.
But, I mean, yeah, I think he'd just need to lose a little.
Probably.
But that's okay. He probably could, especially to do Firefly again. I'm sure he would.
Yeah, so here's the quote. Joss said, I keep thinking they're going to call me, crunch the numbers, and say, hey, we can make money from this. But they don't. He was quoted by IndieWire. He said, I would never rule it out. I love those people, but I just can't wait by the phone. That really doesn't sound as hopeful as the link bait headline was, does it?
No, it doesn't.
he's willing, but he wants the movie studio or the TV studio, whoever owns it, to have to call him and say, let's make the movie. So it's not like he's hunting them down and saying, I really want to make this movie, or trying to sell them on the fact that they can make money on it again.
Right.
I mean, it's been 10 years. Maybe it's about the time.
I think so.
Yeah. He said, it's nice to know that Whedon still thinks about the continuing adventures of Captain Mal. And the gang.
Yeah, exactly. I think that's the best part of that whole news thing is, like, you know, you got a lot of people who say, well, you know what? It's like, yes, I love that show, but I'm not going back there. You know, it's like, it's done. I'm done.
Yeah.
And he obviously doesn't feel that way, which is nice.
Yeah, I agree. Our last piece before we talk about Walking Dead, which we'll give a little more time to, I think, is rumors from Doctor Whoville is that that Amy Pond and whoever her husband's name is.
Rory.
I know, but, you know, she's hot and I don't care about it, so.
I gotcha.
Rumors have been that they're going to kill them off this season. There was going to be a new companion. But it looks like there's some new article here from Blaster that says Stephen Moffat is quoted saying, I'm not very good at killing people. I don't like it. Now, let me interrupt this before and say that Amy Pond said that she thinks she wants her character to die. That's Karen Gillian is her real name, in this coming season. Now, that doesn't necessarily mean that she is, although it's been said for a while now that they were going to kill them. So the quote is, I don't like it. I didn't even know about that myself until Russell T. Davies pointed out that I'd written 6 Doctor Who episodes for him and hadn't killed anybody. Literally hadn't killed anybody. No one dies in The Empty Child. No one dies in Girl in the Fireplace except the person who was dead already. I have killed a few, but I haven't killed my main characters. But that doesn't mean that I won't, of course. Yeah, another more link bait, it seems to me. Another article that had potential to be interesting news, but turns out he was just saying that he'd never killed anybody before. I don't have any more hope because of that article, in other words.
Not me either. Yeah, he's already killed Rory.
Several times.
Yeah.
Poor Rory.
Amy Pond's the girl who waited, and Rory Williams is the guy who died.
Yeah. Isn't he now like an automaton robot or something?
Well, he was, but then when they rebooted the universe, he became human again.
That's right, he became human again.
Yeah.
I forgot about the
universe reboot.
Mm-hmm. They call him the Kenny of Doctor Who in this article.
Oh my God, you killed Rory. You bastards.
Okay, let's get to Walking Dead. The new episode of Walking Dead is on at this exact moment.
Yes, it is.
Everyone on Get Glue should check in and get their sticker.
Yeah, absolutely. That's what I'm doing now. You know, we probably could just get it when we're actually watching it later.
We could.
I don't like to take chances.
Yeah, I don't like to, you know, because sometimes they're like limited time.
Yeah.
And if I don't watch it today, I don't think I can get it again another day sometimes.
Oh, yeah, you can't.
Yeah, I got mine.
Like, yeah, we couldn't get today's tomorrow. Right. But sometimes it's like I've gone to watch it, like, you know, like other shows, like right after the fact. Because, you know, sometimes I'll watch like two shows back to back that are on the same time because I'll DVR one. So I'm watching one live. And I've gone to, you know, get my sticker, Get Glue, when I'm actually watching the other show.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like everybody else got their sticker, but I didn't, because instead of watching it at 9 o'clock, I started at 10:30.
Yeah.
So I was like, I call bullshit on that. So now, I preemptively get my sticker. I know I'm watching it.
So let's talk Walking Dead.
Yeah, let's talk Walking Dead. Shane is crazy.
Shane is nuts. So before we get to Shane acting nuts, let's talk a little bit about the general story. So there'll be spoilers here, but you know, fuck you all.
Yeah, you should have watched it last week.
Should have watched it last. Season finale's tonight. Week. Season finale's tonight. Were you not caught up? Jesus. So Lori decides to go and tell Rick that if it wasn't for her live husband, things might have been different.
Right.
You don't say something like that to Rick. Rick's insane.
Shane, right,
Shane. I have them mixed up again. You don't go tell Shane that, you know, if it wasn't for poor alive Rick, things might have been different. This kid might be yours completely.
Yeah. What was she thinking?
I don't know. You know, I've heard rumors that say maybe she was thinking he would go nuts. She's been whispering in Rick's ear that Shane is nuts and something's wrong with Shane. Maybe she was thinking exactly what we want her to be thinking, and that if he goes a little more nuts, Rick might just have to take care of it finally.
Wow, so that's kind of cold. If that's what her motivation is, that's really cold on Lori's part.
Yeah, I mean, I don't
know.
For
someone who can't drive a fucking car, that's pretty, that's pretty devious.
Yeah, so they buried Dale. And you know, they talk about sleeping in the house. We got a little of that stuff, and who's gonna sleep on the couch? And the old guy Herschel gave his bed to our happy couple.
Right, because you know, being a drunk, he's really good at sleeping on the couch.
Yeah,
basically what he said. Hey, I'm a drunk. I like sleeping on the couch.
Yep. There's a couple things I gotta look something up while we're talking about this. So after that happens, Shane friggin' starts losing his mind, right? He goes to the barn, to their prisoner, and he starts slapping himself a whole bunch.
Like Curly in the Three Stooges.
Yes.
I was waiting for him to be like, whoa, 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 whoa. He was like, oh boy. Shane is crazy.
He is. He really kind of lost his friggin' mind there. Started whacking himself in the head. Slapping himself in the face. So he takes this guy's name is Randall, right? The prisoner. So he takes him out into the woods before they get a chance. They were going to take him and drive him far away again. The silly plan to driving him far away again.
Right.
But before they got a chance, he took him out into the woods and found out where, for some reason, he wanted to know where the guy's buddies were.
Right.
Knowing his plan in the end, knowing what he was going to do, I'm not sure what he was getting at with that. I guess I don't know what he was hoping for, because he needed to know, because they were going to kill him anyway, because in his plotting mind he was worried about them finding them, and after he took care of Rick he would still need to deal with those people. So maybe that's why he wanted to know more information about them.
Maybe. Who knows? I mean, let's face it, Shane is crazy.
Yes, he is. Shane is very crazy. So he kills the guy, right? He breaks his neck off camera. They don't really show it, do they?
No. You hear like a like a thud and a crack.
Yeah, yeah. And so then he hides his gun, and he smashes his face into a tree a few times, breaks his nose, gets himself all fucked up. And of course he lies, and they go hunting in the woods in the dark for the escaped prisoner. Right. That a kid, a 100-pound kid that escaped from Big Giant Shane. And long story short, dead Randall came back to life as a zombie. This is kind of important. Dead Randall's back to life as a zombie, even though he wasn't bit. Now, we've been seeing this a couple times now before this point. I think that's going to be important for tonight's episode. We don't really know yet, because it's tonight's episode, obviously. So they're walking around. Shane is with Rick, right? And Rick is suspicious, I think. Rick is lurking a little bit behind, not letting Shane get behind him.
Yeah, Rick knows stuff that Shane doesn't at this point, I think. I think he knows that, like, Shane was involved in Randall's alleged disappearance. Because, you know, we see Daryl is boarding up the hole in the up above where Carl had once snuck in.
Yeah.
And I'm guessing that Rick probably asked Daryl to do that. And when they get to the shed, it's locked from the outside yet.
Yes.
You know, Shane, for whatever reason, locked it behind him. And his whole thing was like, you know, well, the kid jumped me, got my gun, hit me in the face. And it's like Rick even says, he's like, well, you know, the door is kind of locked from the outside. And he's like, he must have gotten out through the hole in the roof.
Right.
Rick knows. I mean, I know that Rick knows that Daryl has boarded that up.
Yeah.
That kid didn't get out there.
Nope. So he's definitely suspicious. So they're walking, and the other two encounter Randall zombie and kill him. I don't remember their names.
That's Daryl and Glenn.
Daryl and Glenn, of course. Daryl's the one name I didn't remember. Glenn, I remember. I saw an article this week that Daryl's brother, Old One Hand, is going to show up again in season 3, by the way.
Nice.
Yeah. Okay, so we get to a clearing, and the confrontation finally takes place. Shane pulls his gun on Rick, and Rick is like, I'm not going to pull out a gun on you. Why are you doing this? And we can fix it still. And the usual Rick schlock.
Right.
You know, trying to be the diplomat as usual, trying to get him to put down his gun and all that happy shit. And he persuades him to lower his gun, kind of. He convinces crazy Shane to lower his gun. And then he just fucking stabs him to death.
Yep.
It was awesome. I was like, he's finally dead.
Yeah, now I think Rick knew he was going to have to kill Shane from the get-go.
Yeah, I think so, too.
You know, I think he was just, you know, but of course he doesn't want to kill Shane.
No.
Even though Shane is crazy. So it's like, once Shane finally did what he'd done, and it's obvious that, like, you know, it's only one way it's going down, I think he just kept talking because he knew that at that moment, like, you know, Shane would have shot him.
Yeah.
And he did enough to, because he was ready with that knife.
He was, and he was very upset after it happened. You know, he was upset after it happened too. He was like, he knew he was pissed at himself. And
so why did you make me do this?
Yeah. And then his kid comes roaming over the hill with a gun, and we're like, wait, the kid's not supposed to like Shane better. Why is he pointing a gun at his dad? But it turns out, when Shane comes back all zombied,
Shane is crazy,
and what's Rick's kid's name again?
Carl,
and Carl shoots him in the head. Yeah, Carl saves the day. Carl was supposed to kill him in the first place a whole season ago, but we'll skip that part.
But not Zombie Shane. He wasn't supposed to kill Zombie Shane. Right. He was supposed to kill plain old Living Shane.
How come fucking Carl's never in the house when they tell him to stay in the house?
Fucking A. Carl's never in the house.
Never in the house when he's supposed to be in the house.
Fuck you. I'll do what I want.
So all in all, good episode. Good conclusion. I'm happy that all the... Even this article says it very well. It says that it was a big undead enema purging all the Shane, Laurie, Rick melodrama and barnyard follies clogging the narrative colon. And it said, and tonight's episode, I'm pretty sure we'll see a few more nobodies cough, all of Herschel's faceless family minus Maggie cough, bite the dust.
Yeah, well, one of the last things we see is there is a fuckload, I can't describe it any better than fuckload, there is a fuckload of zombies approaching Herschel's farm.
Yes.
Like an army of fucking zombies. on their way.
Yep.
Fuckload.
So yeah, so it was good. I liked it. I enjoyed it. It finally got to a point where, you know, some of the episodes have been annoying me the last, you know, whole season.
Yeah.
It's been better since the break. But this was good.
Absolutely.
Yeah, wrap things up. I was happy.
Now, I think Gallagher would do very well in a zombie world.
Think so?
Yeah, the sledgehammer?
Smashing lots of heads.
Fuck yeah. But now, what is going on, though? I think we're going to find out tonight what's up, but how did Shane become a zombie? Actually, I have a theory as to how Shane became a zombie. It's pretty good. It's pretty obvious, I mean, but pretty good. Not like I'm a genius. I think it's pretty obvious.
Yeah.
But Randall, how did Randall become a zombie?
I think...
So we touched on this a little while ago, because you mentioned the fact that we've seen it before.
Right. Here's what I think. I also think... I think that the scientist guy that they blew up in the end of last season... He whispered in Rick's ear. We were supposed to think he whispered that his wife was pregnant, right? That's what we were supposed to be led to believe. Right. I think what he whispered is that they all are zombies. They all have the gene to be a zombie, and as the survivors die, survivors are coming back as zombies without being bit.
Right. Now Shane. Shane was definitely becoming a zombie. He was getting that whole zombie mindset before he died.
That's true.
Like there was that whole, like, you seen the little horror images that are shooting through his head.
Yeah.
And he's slapping himself and stuff because Shane is crazy.
Yeah.
Now, you remember on that bus, like a couple episodes ago, the first Let's Free Randall episode.
Yeah.
Now, Rick had that new trick of, here, cut your hand. And go, hey, zombie, zombie, hey, zombie, because the zombies smell the blood. They're just like, oh, and then they bring their head closer and you stab them in the head.
Yeah.
Now, when Shane was on that bus, he was doing that. And he wasn't really being careful.
That's true.
And there was zombie blood all over the place.
That's true.
And he's just still rubbing it on the thing.
He rubbed it on the door of the bus so that he can run out the back and try and, because they were all attracted to the blood in the front or something like that, right?
Right. So, I mean, I think Shane may have gotten infected there. Like, whether or not, like, the zombie virus is airborne, or whether or not, like, you know, they all are infected with it, and once they die, you know, they're going to come back. I think that's what happened with Shane. I think it's because Shane was, like, being just really careless with the whole zombie baiting thing.
Yeah, it's possible. I kind of like that idea, too. It's interesting. We'll see what happens tonight. We'll have to watch.
Yeah.
Here, I got this awesome thing that another video, sorry. But this is pretty awesome, and it's another character that we may see come back next season. Or I can hope, at least.
Breaker, breaker, this is Mario. Rick, you said to stay on the line. Want to know where to meet you, Rick?
I'm losing hope that you can hear Rick. Me. But there's always that chance, isn't there?
Yeah, I hear you.
Chance.
Okay.
It's all about slim chances now. I try to do everything right. Keep people safe.
Rick, take your finger off the buzzer. I'm right here. I want...
Our group's smaller now. We lost another.
Can you hear me?
Day before last. It was her choice.
This is sad.
I won't say I blame her. She lost faith. The CDC was a dead end.
Stop talking, Rick.
And a man there. A scientist.
Rick, I have 5 minutes of battery left.
He told me.
Rick, it's
it doesn't matter. What matters is we're moving on. Atlanta's done.
You can't do that.
I'm gonna try for Fort Benning.
You said use the walkie-talkie.
We're facing a long,
you, hard... I assumed you knew how to use it.
Ernie, stay off the road.
Off the roads, copy.
Keep your eyes open.
My eyes are open, Rick. Move.
I don't know, just...
Rick Grimes, you're a policeman. You know how walkie-talkies work.
Just be safe.
I'm not safe. There's zombies.
Rick, signing off.
Take your finger off the button. Rick? Oh, you didn't just hang up, Rick. You can't do that. You can't talk to somebody for 10 minutes straight and not let them talk over. See how I just paused over?
I'm giving you a chance to talk, Rick! Where's my chance to talk, Rick? I don't care about your problems! Rick! No! Listen, this dude, Rick Grimes, says, take the walkie-talkie, you know. If I run into trouble there, partner, I'll come help you. You can meet up with us in Atlanta, Fort Benning. He's a liar, people. He just likes to talk about his problems, complain about his wife and his kid. Zombies out there. Don't got time for this. Use this to talk to your friends, get help. This is not a psychiatrist.
I love that.
It was brilliant.
It's so true, too.
Yes.
It's like, I never thought about that, like, until, like, I saw that. Was like, you know, he's really not giving that guy a chance to answer. I don't remember what that guy's name is.
Neither do I. I have no idea.
I
want to
call him Morgan, but I don't know.
It might have been. Might be. Might be Morgan. Anyway, I guess that's it. I'm excited about tonight's season finale of Walking Dead. I might even watch it tonight.
Yeah, I'll be watching it as soon as we're done here. I'll be making a run for the couch.
Cool.
Yeah.
So that's our show. That's our show. Check us out at nottheshow.com. You can find all of our old episodes and subscribe on iTunes and elsewhere.
And leave a review.
Yeah, absolutely. Leave a review. Download. We have an app. Works sometimes.
Anyway. I think it works all the time.
Nottheshow.com. We're live every Sunday night at 8 o'clock, just about.
Yep.
So that's it. We'll talk. Check out the Discordia 19 podcast at discordia19.com.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, we'll have another show up this week.
And what are we talking about this week? We're talking about Dark Tower and a little bit more about Carrie.
Absolutely.
Before we lay her to rest.
Yes.
For a little while.
All right. So have a good night and have a good week. And we'll see you next time on Not the Show. Mataron a los soldados. Nunca volverán. Dejaron los cuerpos descabezados. Nunca sabrán quiénes son. 12 heads in a bag, left on the side of the road, found in a country God no longer knows. 12 heads in a bag, I swear I read it yesterday, buried like the others on page 27A. 12 heads in a bag, lost count to my dismay. 5,300 must have all got in the way. Some of them down on the pass in old Guerrero State, where one man's back porch is another's graveyard fate. Da da da. You do, wrapped up like garbage, be thankful it ain't you. Found a few in Chiapas, down in Juarez too, where the girls lost all faceless and the killers wear no shoes. 12 heads in a bag, pending family notification, short military haircut, cartel retaliation. For everyone you take, the note says, man, we'll take 10 on the road into the city. The machete always wins. Da da da. Well,
those valley boys, tortured and shattered. Boys will be boys. All the Mexican authorities were offended, or so they say, at the sight of a cartoon that ran on Christmas Day. Da-da-dum, 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 da-da-dum.
That's it, man. Game over, man. It's game over.